Hi, welcome everyone at Startup Tuesday The Hague at Apollo 14. My name is Pinar and I work for Upinion, a social enterprise that is amplifying people's voices in crisis situations. And I would like to take this opportunity to tell you a bit more on how we do this, how we engage and how we amplify these voices. Let me start by showing you our motivation. Why are we doing this? There's a famous quote by Ruba Meissen. She's a Syrian activist and who once said, "Don't talk about us, but talk to us." And with us, she's referring to the millions of refugees and IDPs worldwide who are receiving aid from various organizations and various donors, but who can have much more about this aid that they are receiving. So we think that we can engage more frequently, more continuously with these people. That's where we come in. So as briefly said, Upinion is a social enterprise that developed an online two-way communication platform that engages with communities. And this allows organizations to easily and constantly stay in touch with people in crisis. And by doing so, stakeholders can make their decisions based on the voices of the people rather than about them. And what is even more important about this two-way communication platform, it allows you to share information back. So it's not only about gathering opinions, but it's really providing information that is relevant for the community that you are working with. Of course, we are not blind for the challenges that come with connecting with people, looking at traditional ways of engagement means you have to go into the field, which can be time-consuming, expensive, and sometimes even complicated. In war-torn countries, access to certain areas is difficult or permitted, so this makes the challenge of connecting, of course, visible. This is where we try to support. And we do this with our Upinion Messenger. We have built a platform that allows a secure connection. And we do this by connecting with refugees and communities worldwide through the same messaging apps that people themselves are already used in using. So to connect with their families and friends, think of Facebook, WhatsApp, Fiber, whatever is used in their community, in their geographical area, that's where we jump in. That will be our entry point to really make the connection. Besides these social media, we also, like I said, have our own Upinion Messenger. And it actually works both ways. We have our entry point through Facebook where we can place an ad. And once people click on the ad where they hear about what we're going to do, they are being transferred to this secure layover where all data is collected on the Upinion server. So we're disconnecting from social media in order to keep it safe and secure. We also have a progressive web chat where people can connect with us, which is basically a fancy word for a web link. So a social media account is not even needed in that sense. What we then do actually is we reach a target community within a fairly quickly time. Within 24 to 72 hours, we can have set up a community of people who are engaged with us, who want to talk about various topics that are about them. And once we connect with them, we kind of befriend them, so to say, we gather their insights, their opinions, and their stories. We not only do that by text, but it's very interactive. We can also send out voice messages. People can react back in voice messages or in pictures, emojis, colors, whatever people feel like responding, they have the ability to do so. And like I said, this not only informs NGOs, but it also means that they will receive information back about their situation that is relevant. So from Upinion's side, it seems like you're having a conversation with thousands of people at the same time, while for the person on the other side, it's a one-on-one connection. So it's always valuable to share information like 70% of your community members think the same way about topic X, or you have said that you have this need about a certain topic, within a radius of 10 kilometers, these are the services that are available for you. You can either call the hotline or whatever they have been providing us, we reply to them with referral information that is up to date. And this keeps updating to them. So this way we provide more information, we increase agency of people in the sense that the needs that they are explaining or the solutions that they are providing are being taken directly by the NGOs and they can interact on that. And they also know what is going on in their area, what kind of interventions are being planned. How is this helpful for the NGOs then? Well, of course, if you are planning on rolling out any kind of intervention or any kind of program or policy, you can truly get the participation of the people you are doing this for. So you can measure also how this is being rated by the people themselves. What do they think? Is your approach inclusive? Do you really reach out to everyone in that community? And if there are changes in a situation, does it impact your intervention? And if so, can you change that? So you can really jump into the situation and continue the talk with them about any change that has happened. Just an example, we have a community of over 1,000 people in Lebanon that consists of Syrian refugees, but also Lebanese host communities. And while we are talking about their living conditions, of course, COVID came and swept the world, and this impacted, of course, many livelihoods. So we have been asking them about that. Then just recently in a more specific area in Beirut on August 4, the explosion happened. This will impact, of course, the people living in the area of Beirut and Mount Lebanon. So we have been immediately the day itself been jumping into that conversation with people who are from that area, asking them how it has impacted them, if there are any damages, and also providing them as much as possible with the information that we have gathered about services that were set up. So for your monitoring and evaluation, it's a very good platform where you can, on a weekly, daily, monthly basis, engage with your communities and ask them how it's going. This also, of course, is good for accountability purposes in the sense that if you are being transparent about why you are asking their insights, people will, well, firstly, be willing to answer if they know what is going to happen, of course, with their data, but you are accountable to this group, and it provides them a sense of agency knowing what is happening. So when we reach out, we are always ensuring that we are transparent about why we are asking this. And this will also come back later in our principles and how we work. We provide customized solutions. So like I said, we try to have an inclusive approach. When you are reaching out to people, there's of course a difference between an elder man of 60 years and older and an unmarried young girl between the ages of 15 and 20. So it's good to have different perspectives and to hear about these different perspectives so you can have more tailored solutions. We of course share these insights that we gather. We can do that through our own reports that are interactive as they change as people are providing input. So it means that graphs and tables are kind of jumping up and down, but it means that each time a respondent answers anything or provides something to share, the data will update itself automatically. And we also share our expertise on how to do this. And that, especially with my next slide towards localization. What we are doing is simply a platform to amplify the voices of people. But we cannot be everywhere to do this, of course, and we don't want to do this. It's up to the people themselves. So we rely very much on the people in those specific countries and also local actors who are able to talk and communicate with these people in their own language, using street language, slang, whatever is used to communicate. It's a very informal way. It's a two-way communication, a dialogue. So you don't want to set out surveys that cost half an hour to fill in. It's really a couple of minutes of your time and you're going back and forth. So we rely on the local actors to decide on the tone of voice that is going to be sent out and also when it has to be sent out, depending on what is going on. So we train and strengthen the capacity of local focal points, and then we hand over the communication. Because once we have set up this platform, this community, it doesn't mean that they are only allowed to talk about one topic or one project. They can, of course, share their insights over a variety of topics, as long as they give their consent, as long as it's relevant for them. So that is how we do that, which also means that the community can continue for a longer time, which is more durable. Then something that we get asked quite frequently, of course, you're a digital platform. What about security? What about privacy? We are proud to say that we are ISO certified. We have an ISO 27001 certification, which basically means that we are being audited for the way we handle data, the way we secure, store data, delete data, and also how to act in case of data breaches. We are very strict on these guidelines. Of course, we follow GDPR regulations for quite some time already. But besides these guidelines, these technical guidelines that we adhere to, we also process data sensitively. We follow core humanitarian principles on do no harm. In our case, do no digital harm. You don't want to put any danger into the people who are responding about sometimes sensitive topics like violence against women, about return aspirations to Syria. So we really minimize that by the way we are asking, the way we are connecting through secure connections. And also the kind of questions that are being asked follow the rules of necessity. Like said, we do not ask people to talk with us for half an hour. It's really more like a WhatsApp message. You get a couple of questions and it will take up a couple of minutes of your time, and only those that are relevant for that particular intervention, not for the sake of asking. So with that, we try to really protect the privacy and security safety of our community. Of course, we remain a digital platform, and with that, we have our own challenges when you are using these messaging apps. The first one is about illiteracy. What if you cannot read? And this was, of course, an issue which we have, thankfully, resolved, because I can give an example of how. In Yemen, we have a project where more than 80% of our target group is illiterate. So what we have done is we have rebuilt our web app in such a way that the questions are not only being sent out by text messages, but also voice messages. And people respond back by voice messages, but also by color patterns where they can click on, or by emojis where they can click on. And this makes it fairly easy to communicate with them, as long as there's a little bit of digital literacy, in the sense that people need to know how to navigate a phone, which is surprisingly more the case than you would maybe assume. So we're tackling this issue. Then about connectivity. Or having no phone. Our platform runs on a 2G network, so you don't have to have a super fast Wi-Fi connection to respond, but you get a push notification the moment you are online, and it will remain there until you have the time. Unless it's very urgent, it can only be replied within 24 hours, but then it will automatically disappear. Also having no phone, we have seen that many people are sharing devices. So especially when we are interacting with more younger people, they are used to using their parents' device to interact with us, which is completely fine. Also, in order to ensure that whatever they are saying is not being read by others, we have this private mode in which a question can be pushed, but the moment you provide a reaction to it, both the question and the answer are disappear on that device. So it's not able to get that back. And of course, you can always just completely close the conversation by pressing the X, and then everything will be deleted as well. What else we also find is that using our solution to its full potential requires slightly different perspective from NGOs. Of course, it is nice to be able to engage with your community on a more frequent basis, and like said, this can be on a daily basis, but What are you going to do with that? Are you able, do you have the capacity to truly interact on that? Can you change the direction of your intervention if it says that the majority of your respondents thinks differently? So this means a bit more active approach than maybe if you're used to having a baseline and midterm endline evaluations. This means that you can keep a finger on the pulse for frequent, for a longer time, but with very frequent intervals. So thankfully, organizations, and especially in the Netherlands, The Hague is also very much into encouraging this kind of active participation and with innovative platforms, innovative tools. So I think this is getting more and more normal to organizations. So I would like to sum up in what we are doing, so we can hopefully have a chat about this later on. What I would like to give is that with Youpinion, you can easily and constantly stay in touch with the people that you are working for. You can inform them with your decisions, co-create, co-design with them your interventions, adjust your activities along the way, and especially share back relevant information. And we offer a solution from start to end for any kind of M&E and impact measurements. And if you are interested in trying this out yourself, experience a bit the way how Youpinion works, you can just scan the QR code that will appear here on this screen, and then you will get to try a short demo of how it is to be a Syrian refugee in Lebanon yourself during COVID and answer some questions. It's not active, it's a demo, but it will give you a bit of feeling of how that goes. And of course, I'm here available for any kind of questions that you might have about Youpinion. We love to hear your opinion, so please stay tuned and love to hear from you. Thank you so much.